Let me ask you a question. Has someone ever told you a story that was just way too long? A story packed with so many details, many of which seemed random and unnecessary, that you just wanted them to get to the point, cut to the chase so we can move on? No? Well, if not, then you just might be that person who tells stories that are way too long. For the rest of us, however, you know what I'm talking about. You know, some people feel that way about the Bible, that it's just way too long, filled with just random details, random stories that just seem so unnecessary to the overall plot. You know, I get that. You know, when you do a little research of the Bible, what you find out is that the Bible's 66 books, hear this, were written by more than 40 different authors over a time span of 14 centuries. Written in three different languages on three different continents. Some of the books written were books by kings, others by shepherds and prophets, even poets. Still others were written by church leaders and song writers. Overwhelmed yet? Listen, God's word is not primarily a collection of disembodied truths. It's not a cosmic rule book, not even an anthology of practical insights or a five-step path towards psychological fulfillment, written again by a variety of people with different or random purposes. No, the Bible here, this is primarily a story. A story that reveals for us the remarkable narrative of God's work within our world. You know something, if that's the case, you may be wondering to yourself, well, what then are the basic chapters in this plot line? Like, what are the essential twists and turns, and why should these details matter to us in the here and now? Well, this morning, Pastor Brian and I are kicking off a six-week series of messages we're calling Long Story Short. And what we're seeking to do is just simply take a bird's-eye view of the Bible as a collective whole and show how it fits together perfectly in six major movements. We'll start with creation today, the how and why it all got started. We will then move to the fall, what went wrong. We will consider God's promise to fix our problem in week three as we get ourselves acquainted with God's chosen people, the Israelites. The fourth biblical movement of this narrative will bring us to Jesus. And Jesus is indeed God's answer to fixing what has become broken. And then finally, in week five and six, we'll close out this series by looking at the place and purpose of the church in God's plan of salvation. And finally, we will get a good look at the promise of a new creation when Christ returns and all is restored. You know, again, many people have looked at the Bible as a rule book and even as a religious guide. However, again, the Bible is actually written as a story. A story that is not so much about us, but rather a story that is primarily about God. But here's the cool thing. Even though this is God's story, God wants each and every single one of us to play a part in it. That's one reason why for a year now as a congregation, we have been focusing so much of our time on sharing our faith stories, like Mary Jo did today. Friends, what we want is really for you to become an expert in your story, and then be able to share with others how your story and God's story intersect. To assist you over these 6 weeks, we're going to help you better understand how God's story has and continues to unfold. So when it comes to understanding God's story better and getting just a better picture of who God is, where do we start? Well, that's easy. Let's start at the beginning. Let's start at creation. However, this morning, we're going to look at creation a little differently than you may think. Yes, you're correct if you believe Genesis 1 and 2 were composed to show God as a divine artist who spoke everything into existence. From the setting of the universe in motion to hanging the stars, the sun, and the moon, to creating trees, birds, and beasts, to flowers and flamingos, to everything we see and don't see, God created it all. He is that great creator. This morning, however, we're going to focus our time on one creation in particular, and that's going to be the creation of humanity. I'm going to invite Monica from our congregation to read for us our scripture text for today.
Today's reading is from Genesis chapter 2, verses 4 through 9 and 15 through 18. another account of the creation. In the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens, when no plant of the field was yet in the earth, and no herb of the field had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth, and there was no one to till the ground, but a stream would rise from the earth and water the whole face of the ground. Then the Lord God formed man from the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. And the Lord God planted a garden in Eden in the east, and there he put the man whom he had formed. Out of the ground the Lord God made to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life also in the midst of the garden, and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You may freely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall die." Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, I ask that as we kick off this series, that as I offer up some reflection on your life-giving word, that you just bless the words of my mouth, the meditation of all our hearts, that they be of profit to us and acceptable to you, for you indeed are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, have you ever heard the story about the little girl who was drawing a picture in her kindergarten class, and the teacher asked her, "Honey, what are you drawing?" Well, the girl said, "I'm drawing a picture of God." The teacher kind of smiled and said, "Oh, sweetie, no one knows what God looks like." The girl, not even missing a beat, smiled back and said, "They will as soon as I'm done." You know, as we take this bird's eye view of creation, what we see is how intentional God was, hear this, in creating us from and for community. Again, what did God say when he created Adam in Genesis 2? He said, "It is not good that man should be alone. So I will make him a helper as a partner." And if you take one step back prior to this moment, we read these words in Genesis 1, verse 26 and 27. God said, "Let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness." So God created them, humankind in his image. In his image, the scriptures tell us that God created them, male and female, he created them. So what we have in the creation narrative really are actually two different perspectives on the same creation story. Just so you know, Genesis 1 emphasizes God's sovereignty and then the goodness of the cosmos. Genesis 2, however, emphasizes God's intimate relationship with creation, especially with humanity. And I bring this up because apart from the creation story speaking of God as an artist, it also speaks of the communal nature of God and of his creation. Again, Genesis 1 says, opens up with God saying, "Let us." Who in the world is God talking about here? Let us? You know, throughout the years, the church has come to believe that this was a moment in the biblical narrative that speaks to the communal nature of God. Now, the church calls this the doctrine of the Trinity. I'm going to get you to think a little bit this morning. The doctrine of the Trinity. It's this belief that our universe came into being from a God who is communion, made up of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Okay, how on earth did the scholars draw that conclusion from the creation narrative? Well, you have to dip back into Genesis 1 when it speaks of the Spirit of God hovering over creation. And then you have to fast forward and jump to John 1, where we read the famous words in his prologue to his gospel, that in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and that through him, the Word, all things were made. And if you skip just a couple verses later in John's gospel, you come to learn that the strange and intriguing truth that the entirety of the Bible is pointing to is this Word that came to us in a first century Jew named Jesus. The Word is a man who is also God, whose name is Jesus. Again, Father, Son, and Spirit all together in community create all there is. Now, if this seems confusing to you, because it's really not a terribly long lesson in doctrine of the Holy Trinity, but if this is confusing to you, then you can join the 20 centuries of Christians that have been trying to wrap their heads around this reality. That, hear this, God is one, yet there is relationship within him. Again, creation made from community, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Let me ask you a question. Growing up, how did you picture God? You know, I pictured God as this old guy with short hair, probably not as short as mine, but short hair, a well-groomed white beard. He was a little stocky and was always wearing a dark sweater and a beanie on his head. Weird, I know. But what we really have in God is not a singular old guy with a well-groomed white beard, but rather what we have is a united God with a threefold cooperation. We have sort of a triple unity, a tri-unity, a trinity. And friends, here's the thing. Genesis 1 and 2 speak to the truth that this divine community made up of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit gives birth, hear this, to a human one. In fact, as God goes about creating, it is all good, we're told. Except when we read in Genesis 2 that it isn't good that man is alone. So God takes charge and does something about it. In the midst of this creation, God sees Adam. Let's say he's sitting between a rhino and a raccoon. And he says emphatically, it is not good for this man to be alone. You know, by now, after 6 years of being on pastoral staff here at Church of the Lakes, I hope the majority of you are getting to know me pretty well. And one thing about me that I hope you know is that I just love being around people. I hope you see me as somebody who is approachable and relatable. Now, with all that said, something that has profoundly grieved my soul, or does grieve my soul, is when I either see people alone or think of people who are lonely. Now, throughout this past year, due to COVID-19, this grief has only become all the more pronounced. You know, I know we could talk forever about our country's reaction and approach to this terrible coronavirus. And hear me, I am not at all trying to get political this morning. But to this day, I think one of the worst responses we have had as a country is we have allowed sick people, no matter what the sickness is, to die alone, without loved ones by their side. You know, I am internally grateful for nurses all throughout our country and hospitals who stood in the gap and sat by and even held hands to the dying, with the dying, as loved ones, again, weren't allowed to be there. But to this day, I didn't get it, right? I mean, look, shutting the economy down, closing schools and church buildings, wearing masks, obsessively washing hands, I get it, all right? But letting people die alone? Forcing people to be shelled up in their homes alone? This is beyond being prudent, friends. It feels to me like it's just not human. If I could be so dramatic, it feels inhumane even. Why? Because we were made by community and made to be in community. Friends, we need one another is what I'm trying to say. That's how we were made. The image of God stamped on each and every one of us included this communal element. You know, at the beginning, very beginning of the Bible, God looks upon loneliness in Adam, and he gives his unvarnished opinion. It is, he says, contra diem. It is against God and against God's will. To the go-it-alone existence that we sometimes admire in America, God shouts words of exorcism. Get out, he says. You don't belong. As human beings, we were not only, again, created from community, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but we were created for community. We were created to do life together with God and with each other. So Adam gets a soulmate, and we know her to be Eve. You know, this past Easter Sunday, my family and I sat down in the evening to watch just a fantastic movie on Disney Plus. The movie was called Safety, and it was about a guy named Ray McElrathby, who played safety for the Clemson Tigers football team from 2006 to 2008. And Ray came from a pretty broken home, absent father, mother was in and out of jail and rehab centers due to a drug addiction. Really, he grew up in an environment that many of the kids that we minister and serve at Royal Family Kids Camp come from would be familiar with. Anyways, Ray Ray had a younger brother named Faye. And to keep his brother Faye out of the system, what Ray Ray did was he snuck him on the Clemson campus and tried to care for him quietly, silently, unbeknownst to anyone, while playing football and also taking 18 credit hours of school. Now, I don't want to give away the storyline completely, but what ended up happening is Ray Ray came to realize that for him and his brother to succeed, they needed the entirety of the Clemson community to rally around them, to support them. You know, stunned that anyone would help them, Ray Ray would actually question people's intentions. Yet people would continually respond with words like this: "Ray Ray, we're family. Listen, you don't have to do this alone. We're in this together." Toward the end of the movie, Ray is standing before an NCAA panel of judges trying to get them to waive a violation. The violation had to do with him accepting help from the Clemson Tigers community. And as he's trying to plead his case, he says to the judges, he says, "My brother and I have had it kind of tough growing up. However, Clemson has given me the opportunity to change our lives. My coaches, my teammates, even the people of this community are my brothers and my family too." The Genesis 2 creation story finishes with these words. It says, "Therefore a man leaves his father and mother, clings to his wife, and the two become one flesh. And the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed." At the end of the beginning, it's this image that we have two people in the community standing naked, completely open, completely known, and yet unashamed. Now, this nakedness is far from lacking clothing, although we can chuckle about that, right? Really, the nakedness has to do with a kind of living that allows others to see us for who we are, without judgment and without fear, kind of what Ray Ray eventually experienced at Clemson. You know, some friends, this isn't our reality right now in America, isn't it? Is it? I mean, what went wrong? How did community in America get so muddy and so broken? All right, those are questions that we're going to deal with next week. But for now, let me just say this. If we jump into the New Testament to 1 Corinthians 13, the Apostle Paul speaks of how this existence on earth has become fractured. In poetic terms, Paul comes back to this theme of naked and unhidden community. He says that as of now, we know God and others only in part. As of now, there are parts of us that we hide. There are parts of us that we fake. There are even parts of us that we don't even understand ourselves. So we hurt those we care about. We lower our gaze to avoid the eyes of a stranger. Our love is real, but it's fractured. Things are not as they ought to be. Paul says we know only in part. So why are even broken things broken? Are beautiful things broken? Again, that's a question for next week. But for now, Paul wants to reassure us of something in 1 Corinthians 16 or 13. Here it is. He wants to reassure us that a day is coming when creation-style community will make a roaring comeback. That this fractured world will be healed, that community will rally. Church, our plot line emerges from and for loving relationship. Hear me, we come from and we are made for community, for each other. Praise be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, on this holy day, we just first and foremost want to acknowledge that we were created out of community, out of a God who is three but one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and that in God, in you, there is perfect unity and perfect love. And God, we also want to just thank you for creating us for community. Lord, it is so difficult when we think about people who are alone or lonely. People, whether they're being stooped up in their homes or in hospitals with no one to hold their hand or care for them. Lord, that's not the way it's supposed to be. And I pray that we as your church, Lord, maybe take up the mantle of seeking out those that are lonely, those that are lost, those that just need a friend. and help us to be that friend. God, we love you so much. We thank you that even when we find ourselves alone, that we aren't truly alone because your Spirit is present with us to encourage us, to reassure us, to love us, Lord. And I pray that as your church, we can exemplify that same love, that same peace, that same presence to those in our circles, those around us. We love you, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.